Okay, welcome back. It's a milestone session today because we are covering, going through the final verse of the second chapter. 70, 71, 72 are the final three verses of the second chapter. It is always said that second chapter of the Gita is the most time-consuming chapter. Whenever you conduct Gita sessions, this chapter we need to understand properly. So what I would suggest is we will go through these three verses today, and next week I will do a summary. I will do a quick summary of the 72 verses, the key topics touched, and the next session we will just keep it for open discussion because we wanted to make sure that everybody is clear with the second chapter. Because if you study one chapter of the Gita, I would suggest second chapter is the chapter. Second point is, if you want to get a high-level overview of the entire Vedanta or the Gita or the Upanishads, second chapter gives a end-to-end roadmap. It's such a brilliant chapter. So, with that introduction, we can go to the final three verses of the second chapter. So, we quickly, I try to recap every day, 3-4 minutes I try to dedicate highlighting the major sections of the second chapter. Next week, we will go in detail. But once again, just for your remembrance, the first 10 verses, again, is a restatement of the problem. What exactly is the problem we are addressing? That is the topic. And then from verse 11 to 37, Krishna highlights, right? You have to perform what needs to be done. And this point is highlighted through three different point of views. And the first point of view is a spiritual point of view. Here he talks about what is the reality, meaning from an absolute perspective, from a relative perspective, from an illusionary perspective. Also, he talks about the three dimensions associated with any living being, like the spiritual dimension, the subtle dimension, or the soul, or the physical dimension. So we saw that discussion in detail. And the second point of view was from a dharmic point of view. If you remember, we had an extensive discussion on the topic of Swadharma. Next week we'll talk about that also. We will try to recap Swadharma from a perspective of my own dharma. Do what needs to be done, no matter what. And the third perspective was from the perspective of a worldly point of view. Right. So these were the three angles we saw. And then we move to the third topic, do what needs to be done. But how you do that? How do you gain that skill in action? So for that, Krishna introduced a topic called yoga. So that is from 38 to 53. You saw that whole discussion on yoga. The beautifully the karma yoga is defined. Karmani evaha adhikaraha tve. Ma phaleshu kata janaha, ma karma phala hedru bhuhu, ma de sangustva karmani. That topic we have seen. And also we saw brilliant definition on yoga. What is yoga? Samatvam yoga uchyate. Yoga is equanimity of the mind. Yoga is skill in action. Yoga ha karmasu kaushalam. Ability to pick the right action and ability to execute whatever actions you picked up. So that is, we saw. And samatha vachala buddhi tada yoga mavapsisi. That is the final definition we saw in the second chapter, the third definition, which is yoga is samadhi. Samadhi means it is a well-placed mental state, a mind which is healthy, calm, contented, controlled. That state is called samadhi, and means the ideal word is a well-placed, a stable mental state. That is yoga. So this much we saw, that was the third topic of the second chapter. And we came to the fourth topic, which Arjuna had a question. Are you mean to say that a man of realization, is he going to run away from the world? Krishna was answering that topic. So we have been discussing that. It is the last 18 verses of the second chapter. It is one of the most brilliant spiritual poetry. We talked about that. And we are coming to the topics, the last three verses. So quickly we see the three verses we covered last week, and then we can go to the next three verses. So, Anu, could you please chant verse 67?
Yes. Indriyanam hi charatam yanmano nu vidhiyate tadasya harati prajnam vayurnavamivambhasi.
We talked about the beautiful example of this boat. We spent a lot of time talking about the different type of sailing, all that process. So if the mind do not have the control over the sense organs, that means the sense organs will just go after the fleeting sense objects. So what happens? You will be carried away just like a boat is carried away by different winds in different directions. That means you won't reach in the final destination. This is one of the brilliant example of the Bhagavad Gita. We saw this in detail last week. And we saw about verse 68. Anu, could you please chant?
Tasmad yasya mahabaho nigrihitani sarvashah indriyani indriyathebhyah tasya prajna pratishthita.
So I explained that from 68 to 72 is a recap of that whole discussion. So tasmad, Krishna says, therefore, what you do, you need to control your mind, and with that controlled mind, control the sense organs, and with that, you wander around the world, no problem, absolutely, and your prajna, your knowledge is stable and steady. So that is how a man of realization goes around. He won't run away from the world, he don't need to, because he has that complete control. And finally, he said that is going to lead you to the purest or the most highest type of happiness. So Anu, could you please chant this also?
Yanisha sarva bhutanam tasyam jagati samyami yasyam jagrati bhutani sanisha pasyato munehe.
Another brilliant spiritual simile. So that which is day for a self-realized master would be night for a bhogi. We saw this example. Means I said, just remember one example. What is that example? The rope and the snake. The rope means for a worldly person, the rope is not visible. In his vision, he is only seeing the snake. When he sees the snake, what is going to happen? He's terrified, frightened, worried, anxious, everything. Whereas for a person who can see properly, who has the wisdom, who has the knowledge, what is he seeing? He is seeing the rope as a rope, which is completely invisible, night means that is not visible. So which is completely invisible, not means that is not in the purview of the vision of a person who has not that knowledge. So he is not seeing that rope. As a result, he is suffering. So just like that, a man of realization, he thinks as they are. That objectivity is there. He knows who he is, and he knows his identity, and he knows that he cannot be destroyed, and the death is not an end of his life. Still, remaining in the world, he will act efficiently. He will enjoy the life. So that is the life of a self-realized master. What Krishna is trying to sum up here is, Arjuna thought that, okay, is he going to be like a stone? Is he going to be like emotionless? Is he going to be completely indifferent to the worldly situation, right? When somebody is dying from corona, is he going to be really, really insensitive? Absolutely not. He will engage more than a normal person. Yet, he can look them objectively. He can deal that with efficiently. That is the skill set that is being discussed in this verse. So that is brilliant upama. So from there, let's go to the final three verses. So Anu, could you please chant? And please note that this, a change of meter. So in Gita, you have 2 meters are used. You cannot write a poetry just like that. You have to follow certain rules. The number of syllables, where you have these lagus and the gurus, all that you have to follow, right? So that pattern is followed. And Gita has two meters. One is called Drishtup and the other one is called Anushtup. The most common meter is Anushtup. That is what is Dharma Kshetre, Kuru Kshetre. So 24 syllable per quarter. Whereas here you have 32 syllables per quarter. It is a longer meter. So the tune will be slightly different. The idea of having this meter is when Vyasa wants to highlight something. Mind you, it's an oral tradition. So you wanted to highlight something. You have to highlight that in your mind. There is no paper. There is no Kindle. You cannot do that type of highlighting. The facilities we have in the modern world was not there in the ancient time. So the technique these poets used was change of meter. So the meter got changed. And this is considered, again, I don't know how many examples I called it as the most brilliant example. This is one of the best example to describe a man of realization. Perfect example. You would means appreciate this beauty of this example when we go over this. But let's listen the words from Anu first and then we can go. You might have listened to the change of meter. It follows a different pattern, right? The sound, it sounds slightly different. So this is a simile, a brilliant simile, talks about a man of realization, right? A man of realization is always at peace. That is the point we saw, right? In the couple of verses back. So he tells, Krishna tells, this man of realization, a person attains peace, right? So that is the sashanti mapnoti. So he attains the most powerful or the most authentic peace. The authentic peace he attains when certain characteristics are described. A simile is described. So the simile is Apuryamanam achala pradishtam samudram apa pravishanti yadvat tatvat kamaha yam pravishanti sarvaha sa shantim apnoti na kamakami sa shantim apnoti. He attains the highest peace, authentic peace. How? Like Apuryamanam achala pratishtam. Apuryamanam means if you really have your means when you look at an ocean, you can see the ocean as full. Look at how many square feet of is there for ocean. It is almost infinite vast. This vast ocean, whenever you go to a beach or whenever you see an aerial view, it appears always full. Apuryamanam achala pratishtam. Achala means no movement. It won't go up or down. It is always stable. Stable means the level of water. It won't go down or up. The water in the ocean appears to be always stable and it is infinite. Large amount of water and it appears to be always full. Then he points out one interesting point, right? Apaha pravishanti. Like what happens? All the rivers in the world, look at the river Ganga or the Mississippi or the Nile, all these big rivers. Look at the amount of water they put into the ocean. Millions of gallons of water are poured into the ocean at any moment of time. Yet, even after all the rivers, all the reservoirs, all the water resources of the world, even after putting every second millions of gallons of water are poured into the ocean, yet the level of water appears to be the constant in the ocean. Look at the beauty of that example, right? So now look at the man of realization. A man of realization, he appears always full. But for you and me, I want that promotion. I think, okay, if I get that promotion, I appears to be happy or full. Or yeah, if I get that house, it appears to be happy. Or if my daughter go to Ivy League, it appears happy to me. Or if I can, if I got enough money to retire, it appears to be happy for me. Because we have all have the binding desire. We never are full or complete. And what happens? When a desire comes in, we seems to be go up. And when that, after some time, the level goes down and up for all of us. Right? It's like a well. When there is a rainy season, you can see that the water level goes up. And when the rain goes during the summertime, what happens? The water comes down. But ocean, it stays always full. So like that, a man of realization, he is always full. Even though new desires, unbinding desires or thoughts comes to his mind. But his level of happiness or the level of contentment appears to be full. The difference between a jnani and a pogi is pogi, he has binding desires. Whereas a jnani, like, okay, a jnani may feel that tomorrow I need to go and support that people. People are dying because of corona, so I need to do something. Or, okay, this particular village needs help. Or I need to give that education. The desires are going to come no matter what, even if it's a man of realization. But those desires will not create any disturbance in him, or that desires are not going to add any level up in his happiness. And when that desire is fulfilled, what is going to happen? That is not going to go down. When you take the example of this ocean, there is another thing which is not mentioned in here, but I was thinking about that also. If you really think about, right, ocean, every minute, lot of waters are getting vaporized and it is going up. If you keep a glass of water in a hot, outside, 3-4 days, you can see the level goes down. You all studied this in basic science class. What is that cycle called? Precipitation and evaporation, right? That cycle, you all familiar with that. So the level will go down. And when you pour the water in, the level goes up. That is how every thing behaves. But in the case of ocean, it is absolutely full always. When you put the water in, the level won't go up. When you take the water out, the level won't go down because it is so vast. So a man of realization, tatvat kamayam pravishanti sarve. So just like that, for a man of realization, when new thoughts or desires comes to him, he will stable, he will be completely stable. And that person attains peace and happiness. When Krishna clarifies one thing, right? Not a person, sashanti mapnoti na kama kami. A person who is desiring for the binding desires, desirer of desires, that is the word used. A person completely tossed up with the ups and downs of the desires, that person will never attain peace. So if your goal is to attain that authentic happiness and peace, this is the solution. You need to understand that. The desires will come and go, but you will not be, your contentment won't be dependent upon that type of desires. You might be learn the rules of infinity, right? So what is then infinity? Infinity plus one is what?
Infinity.
Infinity plus a million?
Who's infinity?
Infinity plus 100 to the square of, means to the power 100.
Yes, infinity.
100 to the power of 100, what do you call? Anybody remember that?
Yeah.
Google, that is the name. That is how the name Google came in. 100 to the power 100. Is what is known as Google. Just a sidebar. So any amount added to infinity, still it's an infinity. So the man of realizations, a man of that, such a person's mind is like this. Look, contemplate upon this example. This is such a wonderful example. So just like waters flows into ocean, right? So that is what is yadvat apaha pravishanti samudram. ആപൂര്യമാനം അചല പ്രതിഷ്ഠം. Whenever you see large quantities of waters flowing into the ocean, still it's stable. So too, Tadvat, the wise person, Sa, it's a pronoun, into whom, Yam, again it is a pronoun, Sarvam, all, objects, Kama, enter, Pravishanti, gains, Apnoti, Shantim, the ultimate peace, that will remain unchanged. Whereas, a kamakami, a desirer of objects, na, he will not gain that peace. And a peace that pass all the understanding, the Bible says, it's exactly the same. So this is brilliant. I know every verse I say that it is brilliant, but sorry, these 18 verses, there is no comparison in the world literature to these verses. Please try to appreciate the depth of these verses. It is amazing. These are all objects of meditation, contemplation. If you contemplate upon this meaning, it is very, 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 very relevant. I know one more time, could you please chant? Everybody close your eyes and just listen to this. It's beautiful.
ആപൂര്യമാണം അചല പ്രതിഷ്ഠം സമുദ്രമാപഃ പ്രവിശന്തി യദ്വത് തദ്വത് കാമായം പ്രവിശന്തി സർവേ സശാന്തി.
Brilliant. Any questions? Okay. So let's go to verse 71. So this Krishna want to underline or highlight. That's why the meter change. Now the meter changes back to Anushtup. So let's listen to verse 71.
Vihaya kamanya sarvan umam charati nispruhah nirmamo nirahankarah sashantim adhigacchati.
One more beautiful verse which clarifies some of the question I heard when we started this Sthita Prajna Lakshana. So let's talk about that. Sa Shantim Ati Gachati. He gains that ultimate peace. Ati Gachati means he gains. Sa Shantim means that peace, the authentic peace. He gets that authentic peace. How? Vihaya sarvan kaman, vihaya kamanya sarvan. Having abandoned what? Kaman here means binding desires. Remember, earlier we said that desire is not what the problem. The problem is the binding desires. So even for a man of realization, the desires come. Just like all the rivers pours water into the ocean, all the desires or thoughts will come, but it is not going to disturb him at all. And he may choose to act on something. He may not choose to act on something else, but his being contented is not dependent upon these desires. So having given up all the binding desires, so that is what Vihaya Kamanya Sarvan, Puman, the person, Charati Nishpruhaha, he engages. Charati means moves around. Literally means moves around. Implied meaning is the one who engages in all the worldly activities. He will go and do his classes. He may do and go and do his work. He will be engaging with the family. He will be engaging with friends. He may laugh. He may do everything that is required. Of course, know that he will be dharmic. He will be engaging things properly. So that person is never going to run away from the world. Understand. I think Radhika, you only asked me like, how can you, means, is that means that you will be running away from the world? This verse clearly answers. Earlier also we had this answers. The person moves around the world. Puman charati nishprahaha. Nishprahaha means without that binding desires. With some qualities given. Nirmamo nirahankaraha. Nirmama means what? His typically what happens, these binding desires comes when I have a limited sense of I-ness. Typically, if I think that I am the body, then what happens? Means I will be extremely sensitive. That is what it happens. And if I have an identity with a little bit of higher soul, I will be expanded a little bit more. But when I identify myself with Atma, my Mirmama means that I'm no more identified with that limited I. That I will be expanded. I will be seeing my identity around the world. So that is Nirmama. That is Nirahankara. Nirmama means what? Means he's not just doing just because of it is required for me. No. Dharma will be his first priority. So Nirmama Nirahankara. And what is the benefit promised for this lifestyle? Sa shantim ati gacchati. He is going to gain the ultimate state of happiness. Again, it's a sum up. Krishna is just summing up that whole topic he has discussed so far. So what happens? Once the binding desires are gone, I cannot say that go binding desires, it will not go. If I eat a pill, binding desires will not go. It requires practice. It requires karma yoga and upasana yoga. Once it is gone, with the help of jnana yoga, you gain that self-identity. Then you go around the world and act. Nothing can happen to you. You don't need to be running away from the world. So, and that too, that person attains the highest amount of peace and happiness. Any questions? Otherwise, let's listen to this one more time. Vihaya means having given up. Kaman means what? All the binding desires. Sarvan Kaman means all the binding desires. Yaha means universal pronoun, a pronoun indicating whoever be he. Like he, it could be a male, it could be a female, it could be a Caucasian, it could be an African American, or it could be in the caste, creed, or religion, or nationality. It doesn't matter. Anything that differentiates will transcend here. That is what the universal pronoun use. Yaha. Sarvan, Puman, that person, Charati, engage with the world in a Nishpraha, in an unbinding manner. Nirmamo Nirahankaraha means transcend that limited I, and Nirahankaraha is not bind by that minus and inus. Sashantim Adigachati. So how do you do that? Karma Yoga, Upasana Yoga, Jnana Yoga. Practice of these is going to give you this eligibility. And what is the biggest benefit promised here? Sashanti, the authentic peace and happiness. That is what we will get. Everything else is fleeting. Let's listen to one more time. And then we'll go.
Vihaya kaman yasarvan pumam sharati nispruhaha nirmamo nirahankaraha sashanti madhigachati.
Beautiful. Okay, so let's go to the final verse of the second chapter.
Esha brahmi sthitif partha nainam prapya vimuhyati sthitva syamanta kalepi brahma nirvana mruchati.
Krishna says that this is the ultimate goal of everybody. And let's see. Esha, this is. Sthiti, this is the state of stability. Stability. So remember, the question was sthita prajna. So what is that stable personality? Krishna tells, when a person attains this state, he is said to be in that stable state. And he will be stable in Brahman. Brahman means absolute reality of the universe. So this is the man of realization. This is Thita Prajna, because his prajna, his knowledge, will be always stable and established in Brahman, the absolute reality. And what happens? Prapya Enam. Enam means this. Once you gain this, once you gain the stability, means of the knowledge about Brahman, once you gain the stability, once your knowledge established in the stable state of Brahman, what? Na vimukhyati. He will not be deluded anymore at all. This is the promise given by Krishna. Having gained this, you will not lose it. That is for sure. So having gained, prapya enam na vimukhyati. Once you gain this, you won't be deluded. So you would ask me, why sages in the Purana said to be falling down, etc. They haven't reached this stage. That's what it is. So a lot of people you read as Maharshis or sages, they may not have reached this stage because this is the ultimate. And then he said, Stitva Tvam Antakala Api. So even after gaining this stable state, during one's end of the life, maybe the last year or the last means just prior to the death, right? One Brahma Nirvana Gachati. He will get liberation. Liberation means moksha, the Jivan Mukti. Meaning thereafterwards, no more rebirth for him. Whatever is his Sanchita Karma pool, if he realized this truth in his lifetime through the knowledge, right? This is the knowledge. Knowledge means I am the Atma. And if you can establish in that state, even at the end, means during the last period of your life, you will gain the liberation. Brahma Nirvana Gachati. So one get the liberation. Nirvana is the term used here. Nirvana means literal means vana. Nirvana means blow out. You just exhaust. So what? All the ignorance. And what remains is your own true nature. So that is.
You don't have any alarms.
You. My God. The CD picked up the word. Sorry. So this is the state. This is the ultimate goal. Esha Brahmi Sthiti Partha. This is the state of. Means the stable state in Brahman. And once you gain this, there is no delusion. That is the second sentence. Having gained this, one is not deluded. And if you remain in this state, even at the end period of your life, you will be liberated. This is the greatest promise. This is the ultimate goal of every spiritual seeker. That is how Krishna concludes the second chapter. So with this, he concludes the 18 verses and he concludes the Sthita Prajna Lakshana. He explained that Sthita Prajna is a person who has already reached this knowledge. It's a self-realized master. He is not a yogi who is striving for it, but the one who is already attained this state. And his characteristics were given. And one thing he tried to highlight here in 2-3 verses brilliantly is the fact that that person will, he will be engaged in the world even after that, right? So that's not what is being taught here. So,
what is the significance of, say, mentioning at the end of the life, Rajesh?
Because somebody may ask, right? So, if you get this realization at the last year of his life, is there any rebirth for him? Because that's a common question people will have. No. The moment you realize this truth, you will be liberated. So, he will gain Jivan Mukti. Remember, in the 8th chapter, we talked about the two types of muktis. One mukti is Jivan Mukti and the other mukti is Krama Mukti. Because yes, if you have gained this knowledge, but you are very close, what happens? You will not be reborn in this earth, but you will be reborn in a higher plane where you will be exposed to this teaching further and you will get Krama Mukti. Just to clarify that, if you realize this truth here in this world, then there is immediately liberation. And after that, there is no turning back. That is what the promise given.
Okay.
So this is going to generate a doubt in Arjuna, and that is how the third chapter opens. But this concludes the second chapter. It's such a beautiful chapter. I would request all of you, means we'll chant next week, or means once we do the summary, we can chant this chapter also with the help of Anu, and then we can move on to third chapter. But this is brilliant. This is one of my favorite chapter. This is as I said, like the ancient style was the first chapter gives the end-to-end picture of the content of the book, and the second chapter touches almost all the topic. Now from chapter 3 to chapter 17 is an elaboration of the topics discussed or mentioned in chapter 2. So for example, chapter 3 is such an important chapter. We are going to talk about Karma Yoga, because Karma Yoga, if you really think about Bhagavad Gita, one of the central teachings of the Bhagavad Gita is Karma Yoga. We are going to see that in the third chapter. But hereafterwards, it's all elaborations.
Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti 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 Shanti.